In Charlottesville, Virginia, more than 4 years after white supremacists descended on the city, jury selection is now underway in a civil trial against the organizers of the Unite the Right rally. 10 people, including town residents and counter-protesters, are seeking unspecified damages from 24 defendants. The plaintiffs say they suffered physical and emotional injuries during the 2 days of clashes in August 2017. Hard to forget the images from that weekend. White supremacists marching with torches, chants of "Jews will not replace us." Dozens of people were injured. One person, Heather Heyer, died, was killed in the chaos that followed. CNN's Elle Reeve has more on this new legal battle. She was there that weekend. She stayed on this story ever since.
Jews will not replace us! Jews will not replace us!
Imagine. I've never, ever seen anything like this, Elle.
It was
literally crazy.
It was so violent.
It was like a civil war happening.
On a Saturday morning.
Tanisha Hudson and I came within a few feet of each other on the morning of the Unite the Right rally in 2017, hours before a white supremacist drove a car into a crowd, killing a woman and injuring many people. I interviewed her after.
This is the face of supremacy. This is what we deal with every day, being African American.
I just knew something bad was gonna happen that day. I think free speech ends when violence begins, right? I can say what I want. I can't do what I want.
That's at the center of Signs v. Kessler, a federal civil lawsuit against the organizers of the rally that goes to trial this week.
Many of the plaintiffs in our lawsuit were here that evening. They had been peacefully standing there protesting white supremacists coming to their town. Surrounded, beaten, punched, kicked, all while these extremists were chanting things like "Jews will not replace us" and a variety of other violent, racist, anti-Semitic chants. What happened that weekend was in many ways intended to be a surprise. The violence was planned in these closed Discord chats where they discussed everything in advance, from what to wear, what to bring for lunch, how do you best sew a swastika onto a flag, how do you use free speech instruments to attack people, cracking commie skulls, quote unquote. That is a racially motivated violent conspiracy, and that's not anything that's protected by the First Amendment or by any other sort of right that people have.
The defendants are men who made themselves white power brands. Richard Spencer, Chris Cantwell, Jeff Scoop, Matt Heimbach, Andrew Anglin, Jason Kessler, and more. They've argued they were simply engaging in their First Amendment right to speech and protest, and that the violence is the fault of the police for not separating them from the counter-protesters. But what made the alt-right grow so quickly, the internet, has been its undoing in this case. Because the defendants left behind an enormous paper trail of what they say were jokes about racial violence.
With an event like Charlottesville that was national news, people may have seen the torch march, they might have seen the car attack on the news, but if you look beneath the surface, there's just so much more. And what that evidence shows is that there was a conspiracy to commit racially motivated violence.
The discovery process has turned up documents that, beyond what they might mean for this lawsuit, reveal to the public how this movement worked. The exhibit list contains text messages that show extensive planning among leaders who have tried to distance themselves from each other since 2017. They show an embrace of violence, and they show they weren't just jokes.
Is there like one comment that stands out at you?
The image that has stuck with me ever since the beginning of the case was one of the Discord post pictures. It shows a tractor running people over, and it's called the Protester Digester. Look, there's many posts in this case about running over people with cars prior to the car attack on August 12th. But that one to me was like, I can't get it out of my head.
Hundreds of fascists on all sides.
If you're saying organized violence on the one hand is not protected by the First Amendment, but speech that does talk about violence is protected, there's obviously going to be a question of where along that spectrum can you say the law should step in or the First Amendment doesn't protect you. And that's what this case, I think, is interestingly going to be about, which is, what is that line? You have to understand the nature of internet communication and how much that changes the nature of incitement.
In a sense, like, no matter what the verdict is, you have already won, because Richard Spencer said it was financially crippling. Heimbach has quit white supremacy, at least officially, so has Jeff Scoop. They don't hold public rallies anymore. Whatever they might be doing behind the scenes, they're not able to get numbers in public. What do you think about that?
People really need to understand that this is real, that it's out there, that it allows people from all over the country and the world to organize in ways that were previously impossible, and that's a real and present danger.
Tanisha says that despite all the national attention Charlottesville got after 2017, it didn't change the systems that benefit white men. That there are two systems and two sets of standards, whether that's for leaders in city government or people fighting in the streets.
I probably could have literally kicked one of their asses that day. But if I put my hands on them, I'm going to jail. But they did it all day, and they got to go home free.
Well, it's very interesting that this civil lawsuit has been the biggest consequence for those organizers, not facing, like, criminal charges.
Right.
What do you think about that?
I knew nothing was gonna happen to them. Why would it? The police are on their side. I mean, we just watched this replay again on January 6th, and I remember posting when the insurrection happened in the Capitol, hey, D.C., Charlottesville told you so. You believe us now? This is what they did to us. They invaded us. But now that it happened at the Capitol, it's, oh my goodness, they need to go to jail. Well, we told you they needed to go to jail here, and they didn't go to jail. Charlottesville could have did the right thing and made such a big statement, and they didn't. Charlottesville failed us. And then after Charlottesville failed us, our president failed us.
And Elle Reeve joins us now. Do we know what sort of legal strategies the defendants are expected to use once the trials get underway?
Yes. The plaintiffs have to prove both racial intent and a conspiracy to commit violence. And the defendants do not deny that they are racist. They're not even embarrassed by it. But they do deny that there is a conspiracy. They say that they didn't really know each other, or if they did, they didn't like each other. The working class white supremacists say they weren't invited to the events hosted by the fancy white supremacists. And they say that for all the violence, that's the fault of the police for not keeping the protesters separate from each other.
Elle Reeve, as always, remarkable reporting. Thank you.